Good evening. I'd like to open the Deerfield Planning Board meeting on December 5th, 2016, at 7 p.m. at the town offices, 8 Conway Street. And the meeting is open to the public. Our agenda tonight is to review the minutes from potentially September, October, and November meetings. Review some mail, ask if there's any comment, public comment. And then we have two public hearings, a site plan review for 31 Elm Street, which is regarding Cumberland Farms, including the stormwater plan. And the second is the Grandview Estates. It's a continuation from the last meeting. In our reviews, but apparently we don't have any tonight. The seventh item is about the subdivision, the two-family senior residential plan for 67 Sugarloaf. If the MEPA site visit report is available, we can look at that. And then any other business not reasonably anticipated 48 hours prior to the posting for this meeting. Then we'll set another date for the meeting and then adjourn. Is there anything else anybody wants to add at this point? All right, can we look at, so the September minutes we are actually approved and they just needed to be a couple corrections. So that will take care of, and that's an administrative thing I'll do with the staff. And then we have October and November's in front of us. Can we read October? October minutes, does that look good?
Yeah. All right, to me, I make a motion.
We're missing time.
I'll look up that time. I think it's written down. I don't know why it's not on there, but.
Either one.
It's probably at least 9 o'clock.
Yeah, that was.
Yeah, we can pick a time because I think if we want to say 9 o'clock, that's good enough with me.
Yeah, this was not a quick meeting.
No.
Okay.
It was 9 o'clock. Yeah, they look good. So we have did you second that?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain.
I need to abstain.
Who abstained?
I did.
John abstained.
There, so it's
5-0-1.
5-0-1.
And who made the motion?
I.
Okay, Kip. Seconded by Rachel.
Then we have November 7th.
Mm-hmm.
was, the plan was prepared for Bonita Weeks. I thought it was, the 264 was Malcolm Thompson. Does that make sense to anybody else beside me? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, we should have it in here.
Well, it was forwarded from the week before.
What was forwarded?
So, we had an A&R in front of us in October.
Was that the one with Dan Werner?
Yeah.
Yeah, he, did he?
But he didn't have any name on it, so he wasn't there. So then he came last meeting.
Right.
But I thought it was, it says here, a plan prepared for Bonita Weeks. But to my mind, it was Malcolm Thompson.
Well, that's his daughter.
Whoever it was, somebody told me that.
But it was his name on the.
It was his name on the plan?
It was his name on the plan, not hers.
Although, they usually have both.
But didn't I hear that it was turned down? I wasn't at that meeting, but I heard.
Applicant was Bonita Weeks.
Okay.
That's Mickey's daughter.
Yeah.
She must be the official title.
I appreciate that, but yeah.
I have no idea.
This was the funny horseshoe lot?
Yes.
Bonita Weeks?
Yep, so apparently she's the land, she's the making proposal, but her name didn't come up in Dan's discussion of it. We never saw the plans because.
Yeah, we saw it.
That's, I'm sure, his name on it, hers, but anyway, that's fine. These were, the topics for the next meeting were proposals, things that we're going to look into, but they weren't necessarily anything we're going to bring up, it's just things that were, for instance, the marijuana district overlay, we did some work on that before, we're going to review that coming into another meeting. She says Rachel's some help here.
So we'll take that off.
So you can just take it off, I mean, I think those are things that we.
It's actually not a bad thing to have on minutes, is what we were saying, we're going to be on the next meeting.
Worthy of further investigation, but that's all.
So we're deleting topics for next meeting?
Well, they're just, no, I think you leave them, but just clarify that they weren't topics for next meeting so much as they were topics that we need to be.
Discuss.
Yeah, discuss at some point.
Topics for future discussion?
Right, we need to stay diligent.
Yeah.
With these particular items.
Yeah, it's actually good to have on the minutes, I think.
Yes, it is.
Okay, so we'll cross out the next meeting and just say for future discussion.
Yes.
And Rachel's in charge.
Take out Rachel's some help here.
Oh, Rachel's not in charge? Huh?
No, I was just taking notes because we were in.
Well, I don't think it really needs to be changed, they are topics for the next meeting. If we get to them, fine, and, you know.
But we need to do some research on all of them, I think that was the thing, too. It's not like, you don't want to bring them up just out of the blue.
It would be old business, you know.
Motion?
What time did you adjourn?
I wasn't at that meeting, so.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the minutes.
Well, but what about the time you adjourned, do you remember?
Eight, it was a quick meeting.
Yeah, it was.
8:30-ish.
Eight o'clock?
It was pretty close to 8:30.
Yeah, all right.
8:30, okay.
But Roger wasn't there, is what he said.
I wasn't at that meeting.
I wasn't either.
Right, so you might switch him over from present to absent.
Oh, change that?
Yeah. Okay, some kind of liability or lawsuit, I wasn't there.
Right.
No, we're bringing you down.
The future topics.
And then endorse at the very bottom of page one, it should be an O, endorse the A&R plan. And then on the top of page two.
Endorse. Okay. Oh, and then on the previous minutes we did, my name was spelled wrong, we left the L off. I'll tell her, put it on here.
You'll get that correct. The top of page two, it says that the plan was to correct a property line. We, I don't think we get involved in whether correcting or not, it's to change a property.
Right.
So if we can, it's saying that we corrected a property line, it's just to change.
Change a property line?
Yeah, because.
Okay.
I totally agree.
It's if.
There's no error.
If the applicant thinks it's correcting, that's there, but for us, we're just changing a property.
Okay.
And then do that and that, yeah, great.
Okay.
Do we have a second, Frank?
Second.
Who moved them?
John.
John, okay.
Yeah, well, I'm going to restate that, accept the minutes with the slight changes.
With the slight changes, yep. John B. and Rachel, you second it?
At least you got to finish yours.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained?
Two abstentions, 4-0-2.
Sorry, did I move too fast? We usually don't do that.
That's all right. I'm good. We got the point across.
Well, we can do the mail at the end. Let's move the mail down. I don't know. Usually that's down further.
Yeah.
Is there anybody here from the public who would like to make a comment that's about something that's not already on the agenda? Moving right along. Public hearing. So this is it right here. Good. So let me read the announcement of the public hearing for the first item, 31 Elm Street. Notice is hereby given that the Deerfield Planning Board will hold a public hearing on December 5th, 2016 at about 7 o'clock at the Deerfield Town Hall, 8 Conway Street, on request of Bacon and Wilson, PC, representing Cumberland Farms, Inc., for a site plan review pursuant to sections 5400 and 2230 of the Deerfield zoning bylaws. Cumberland Farms, Inc. proposes to construct and operate a retail convenience store and vehicle filling station on property at 31 Elm Street, which is Assessor's Map 168, Parcel 63 and 64. The site is currently commercially zoned at C1 and is expected to occupy 85,298 square feet of area.
You need to sign in if you're...
Copies of the site plans and the site plan application are available for inspection at the Deerfield Town Hall during regular business hours. And this was published in the local newspaper on November 21st and 28th. Notices were sent out to butters, and we have the...
If you have a card, that would do it, too.
Receipts that show people received them. And let me just... this was also being reviewed by the Deerfield Conservation Commission, and they... if you remember, hired Greg Newman from Newman Environmental Engineering, and we have a report from them.
You want to see them? Okay, I just need a back.
Let me just see what else we have.
Yeah, no problem.
We should have the site plan. Can you? Oh, here we go. Oh, we got lots of reports up here.
There it is.
Huh? Stormwater management reports and traffic impacts. Great. Is that what we should have?
Traffic impact study.
That's what I'm...
What do you have there, John?
So we've got a site plan set. It looks like we've got one for everyone. This is great. Yeah. I should have said at the beginning of the meeting, we have a quorum tonight. Paul, Roger, Kip, John, Rachel, John, 6 out of 7. And so we would ask that...
These are the big ones.
So now, what are the other packets that are there, John? Should I put them in the minutes or not?
Yeah, but let's have an overview first. And then
okay,
we can
all right.
So thanks for coming. If you can let us know who you are and who else might be here representing. And actually, at this point, I'd like to ask Pat Smith, our consultant from the Franklin Regional Council of Governments. Could you come up to the table and participate?
If I could get a copy of those plans, too, that would be awesome.
Is there another set there? Okay.
Actually, I might have given away mine. So if you could let us know, who you are and who's with you.
Go ahead. Yeah, no, you can have it.
Okay, my name is Phil Henry, civil design group. We're the civil engineers on the project.
I guess a few procedural, I guess last minute, our client, T.M. Crowley, who's the preferred developer on behalf of Cumberland Farms, they could not make it, as well as the local land use attorney. He had a family emergency, if you will, so he cannot make it either, so.
So you're all by yourself?
I'm all by myself.
He's got some.
There you go.
Sorry, sit back.
So, well, I guess what I'd like to do is perhaps run through an overview of the project, give you some feedback from the feedback that we received based on conservation as well as ZBA last week, and then I'm happy to go into, you know, dive into anything further. So the site is located at 31 Elm Street, at the intersection of Elm Street and Route 5 and 10, Elm Street being up and down on the page, Route 5 being along the bottom of the page. And as I'm sure you're familiar, there's an existing house right here at 31 Elm, and then it's largely surrounded by lawn area, side and rear yard lawn area. The proposal is to remove that structure and to, in its place, construct a 4,700 square foot convenience store with its main entrance facing Route 5. It also has a side entrance that would also face Route Elm Street. And that would be supported by 27 parking spaces, much of which is in the front spaces are in the front of the building, as well as there's some side parking as well. What you see here, these are the product dispensers, the fuel pumps. There's four of them, and as typical, you can load from both sides, so it could actually house eight vehicles at once. And those are spaced at 35 feet apart, so to give it some good spacing, such that cars can be loaded at the pumps, and actually somebody can drive right through if need be. Over here in this corner, this is the underground storage tanks, two 20,000 gallon tanks. Fuel offerings are diesel, 87 gas, and then 93. And then there's actually a sump underneath each dispenser that allows, you know, the mixture of such to create 89 or 91 octane, depending on what they're offering here. The diesel dispenser is this one on the left, so there's actually two separate nozzles or handles, if you will, one for gas, one for diesel. Some other site amenities are, there's an outdoor seating over here on the left, and that is just a seasonal amenity. It's the chairs and the table is fixed to the ground. Obviously, it's not operating during the winter time, and it's, they found based on research that it's not to promote any restaurant use or to have anyone stay there for a period of time. I guess it's more just for someone that decides to eat outside in lieu of their car or something like that. We are proposing a 6-foot-high privacy fence along the rear portion of the building, totaling about 310 linear feet. That would be a white 6-foot-high privacy fence. Access will occur via a full access curb cut on Elm Street. Full access meaning full movements, left in, left out, right in, right out. And then on Route 5 and 10, there's a restricted access, right in and right out. No left turns in and no left turns out would be allowed. Currently, we are in the process of seeking approval with DOT. There was a few layers that we actually had to go through with DOT. That's actually a no access right of way, meaning that you cannot actually have access. However, from what the feedback that we heard from DOT is, a lot of Route 5 and 10 was no access, and as applicants are requesting access, they're lifting those access points, no access points, in certain locations. And this would be a site where they've entertained granting that access. So we got some feedback from DOT. This actually was not the original driveway layout or design, so the fact that they're interacting with us gives us a good indication that we will seek approval. We just have to go through the process.
So this one on this site here, if somebody's headed north, they can enter, and if they're headed north, they can leave, and that's it?
That's right.
Yes.
Okay.
The site will also propose new landscaping, sporadically around the site, there'll be 11 new trees, over 40 shrubs, and over 250 shrubs and ground cover and grasses, mixtures throughout the site. And we're also maximizing the salvation of the existing trees here. So if you're looking at this plan, all the trees that are in black or hollow are the existing trees that are to remain. So we're doing our best to keep the footprint as small as possible in that regard. Dumpster and trash location over here on the right. There also will be an air tower offering on the right-hand side as well.
Excuse me, what?
Yeah.
Air tower, air tower, filling up your tire. Thanks. And where is that going to be? On the right-hand side, over here. This is the site plan, but it's a rendering, so I've taken all the text off. CFG 4.0 in your packets has all the text and the leaders on this, so there's a bit more information, but this is just simplified for presentation purposes.
You said 8.4?
4.0.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry?
4.0. So last week we were in front of the ZBA for special permit for use, and some variances for signage. And we had a very good conversation, very good hearing. The synopsis was that they closed the hearing and they're seeking some additional information. And that is they want letters of support from fire, police, DPW. So our team is contacting the town to try to get that information, get that letter. There's no indication that there is an issue. There's just been radio silence in that regard.
So that's all information that we want also. So
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And usually when you don't comment, that means that's good. So people usually just comment when they have a comment. So, but needless to say, we are tracking that down.
Yeah, we'll wait. We'll
and that's just since last Thursday. Did you put those out before?
Well, we filed with the ZBA probably about a month ago, but yeah, we had the hearing last Thursday.
Could you just remind us which principal use this comes under?
This is the, I think it's under motor vehicle service or gas station use. Mm-hmm. I don't have the bylaw in front of me.
Motor vehicle service station. And in C1, it's a special permit, so that's why you're...
That's why we're in front of ZBA. So tonight, we're here for site plan review of outdoor storage and advertising, I believe, and then for the stormwater permit as well.
There's wetlands involved with that site, right?
Yes.
So that means that conservation is the stormwater agent.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
This question had come up at the last meeting, so I did some further research into it in regard to the authority of planning board and stormwater permit versus CONCOM. And the fact of the matter is that while sort of in the past there's been, I think, a notion that if CONCOM had jurisdiction, then the planning board did not need to issue a stormwater permit. And the fact of the matter is that CONCOM has jurisdiction only over certain portions of properties that involve wetlands. The planning board's stormwater permit authority still applies to all the remaining portions of the property. So you would actually have, each board would have jurisdiction over certain pieces. I spoke with Debbie Schreiber, who was the consultant that had helped you develop all this to try to sort it all out. So really, you know, what you've done in the past and working with CONCOM and sharing peer review engineers has been great, and I think it's set up a good process. But typically what she suggested should happen is CONCOM should do what they're going to do to review the stormwater issues that relate specifically to the wetlands, and they should transmit that information to you so you can incorporate that in a broader stormwater permit. And this particular project would seem to trigger both of those jurisdictions, sure, as you've indicated.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So ZBA, as I said, closed their hearing, provided we get some information. They didn't have any real issue with the signs, other than the fact that they did not like the, I guess, flashing or toggling or movement of certain aspects of the freestanding sign. So
will it be internally lit too?
It will be internally lit. And we've brought that back to Cumberland Farms, and we're all but going to essentially remove all that toggling or flashing, if you will.
Isn't it going to be similar to what they have in the center of town now? Because that sign changes and flashes.
It does. And as I understand it, as part of this new permit, that will not be allowed. So there'll be no flashing, other than being able to change it, you know, once a day as gas and diesel price changes. But there's no toggling every 30 seconds.
No members thing.
Exactly.
That'll stop.
Yep.
Okay.
Was that a request from you folks or a request from the ZBA?
That was essentially a requirement from the ZBA.
Oh. I'm just curious as to why they changed their mind when they allowed that one to go in the center of town. You know?
Mr. Chairman, I'm just looking at your general sign restrictions, and it says no sign or advertising. This is section 3234.
Yeah.
No sign or advertising device shall incorporate motion or be lighted by flashing or blinking lights or utilize a change in light intensity or be internally lit. Mm. So everything
but the internally lit will still be internally lit.
Yeah, so we got essentially everything that we wanted to get varied, we got varied with the exception of the toggling or movement or changing of signs, electronic signs. And then about a month prior to that, in October, we were in front of the Conservation Commission because obviously we're within jurisdiction. There's wetlands along the southerly edge of this property, essentially where the dark green color is, and then there's a finger that extends up for which we need to cross over, which is actually technically on DOT property. Our right-of-way or our property line is this black line here. It's about 40 feet off the edge of road at its nearest point and diverges from there as you go south.
It's DOT, you said?
DOT. Needless to say, the 100-foot buffer extends back onto the property and extends up, hence we were within the local jurisdiction. And we had submitted a stormwater report and analysis, which is the same stormwater report that's in front of you tonight. And as you alluded to, Mr. Chairman, this project was reviewed by Mr. Newman, and he had issued some remarks about the actual plan itself and the stormwater report. I have spoken to Mr. Newman, and basically the general consensus was that we can respond to all of them, all the comments that he's issued. We were, as an applicant, if you recall during our informal meetings, Mr. Chairman, we were led to believe that the groundwater separation or lack thereof of 2 feet could be waived locally. If you recall, during our informal meeting, the building inspector, conservation chair, we all had discussed doing some digging out there during the design process. And it turned out that groundwater was a bit higher. And that's estimated seasonal high. That means at one point in history, that water had extended to where we saw modeling. Recent testing and monitoring wells have indicated that groundwater is actually not that high. Needless to say, we did the testing, and it turns out that groundwater is about 1.35 feet below our basin floor. Our basin floor at this point is fixed, and that's based on being able to drain the water via gravity through a treatment system and into that system, into the above ground system. If you go to CFG 5.0, and perhaps maybe it's a good time for me to go to that as well.
Because that was expected that it was high.
It was expected that it was high based on our ground, based on the borings that they do for geotechnical purposes. And borings are the, you know, the 4-inch cylindrical drives, whereas a test pit, you get a backhoe on site and you dig a 4x8 or 4x10 foot hole. The test pits are a better indicator of groundwater and modeling because it's a, you get a wider profile than a boring. And we did not see groundwater that high. It was simply the redox, the actual modeling itself, which indicates at one point water was that high. And sometimes that takes, that redox takes a while to go away, sometimes decades. So, but needless to say, that's where we saw it. We are somewhat fixed on our basin floor, which is over here. And we have a basin floor of about of elevation 200. That's our proposed basin. Groundwater is at 198.65, hence the 1.35 feet of separation. Based on the initial borings and environmental and geotechnical studies that have been done here, there's an underlying clay layer underneath the sand. So there's about 15 feet of sand, and underneath that is clay. And basically what that translates to is the geotechnical engineers have estimated settlements over years. And on this particular site, there's some pretty significant settlement. We're talking, I think, 5 or 6 inches over an extended period of time. And each foot increment adds either settlement that is going to occur or mitigation during the construction process to get rid of that water in the clay, so that it can consolidate. What they decided to do, our client decided to do, was try to put the building as low as it can be, based on the information that we had available at that time, which was elevation 204. So as you can see, elevation 204 for first floor elevation of the convenience store to elevation 200, we only have a 4-foot separation to drain the site via runoff on the surface and then collect water, get it into the pipe. So all that takes up space. So basically, we essentially need a 4-foot vertical separation, if you will, from whatever the first floor is going to be to discharging our pipes into this basin. Again, based on the prior to doing the digging, the test pits, the geotechnical information indicated that groundwater is a bit lower. Therefore, we thought we had the 2-foot separation. Mm-hmm. Hence, so the evolution of this conversation is when we were at the informal meeting in late fall. They said, let's do the testing and, if need be, seek a waiver. It turns out that perhaps the conservation is not. I spoke to the chairman, and he said, speak to DEP, the district DEP. So I had reached out to Mark Stinson, and he basically referred me to the general office in Boston. And DEP is under it's their understanding that you need to provide the 2 feet of separation to groundwater. So, and that's really the only sticking point in that comment letter. And
from Newman.
So, we had a good conversation. I think in some cases we disagreed on our approach, but needless to say, I think we can overcome everything. The issue is that groundwater separation. So, I actually did a mounding analysis, which is typical when you have less than the requisite groundwater separation. And based on the calculator that I use on using the Hantuchian method, which is the industry standard method for using that, modeling only occurred a half an inch back rising above what is considered the estimated seasonal high. So even in a 100-year storm, that water from the water in the ground will not extend up into that basin. It will only extend about a half an inch or an inch from what it currently is now. Needless to say, that's based on my conversation with DEP, that is not sufficient. So we need to take a look at perhaps other ways of managing stormwater, breaking it up into different sections, or perhaps if we can raise the site even a half a foot, I think would help us. So I think we have a little bit of homework to do on that. And, you know, it's unfortunate, because I think this design is the best suited design for this property. But needless to say, I think we're going to have to take another look at some certain aspects of the grade.
Couldn't you just raise the building and parking lot?
Yes, we can. If you look at it in a vacuum. Yeah, if you look at it in a vacuum, but every foot or every half foot that gets raised equals dollar amounts of mitigation during construction. And apparently they're very significant figures, because it's a process of essentially draining that water from the ground. So I don't pretend to know all about it. All I was directed to do is to use 204 as my first floor elevation.
I'm curious, when did you do the test pits? Was it this past summer? Before last?
We did the test pits in the fall, actually, in September.
Fall.
So, and that was after we had done borings and drilling and installing monitoring wells in May of last year. So those monitoring wells did not indicate that groundwater was that high. And based on some folks around town, they think that groundwater does not get that high anymore. But that's what we found. So unless, provided new information that groundwater does not actually extend that high.
You said that the folks from town said that groundwater doesn't get that high anymore?
In speaking with the building inspector, who actually...
Because, I mean, we've been hearing the exact opposite. So
that it gets higher?
Yeah, that's...
Overall,
it's always an issue.
Well, I mean, needless to say, a foot and a half is pretty shallow. So, we have to work around that. Again, we have to either raise the site a half a foot, or perhaps get creative with some of the stormwater management. So that's where we are today. So we have comments from conservation. We have comments from the ZBA, and then we'd like to get the comments from this board, and then revise the plan once.
So just quickly, because I spoke to Steve Barrett of the chair of the CONCOM, and basically they hired Newman, and then also they know that this is has to go through the DEP, and they've the last couple projects they've liked working with DEP and let them give them some direction. So that's what they're still doing, and you know, we're certainly not, well, we're unlikely to do much different than them.
And we're not asking to do anything different. I think it's just something that we have to address.
I mean, groundwater is an issue with every project we do in Deerfield, in South Deerfield. Yeah. So
the sump that collects all this water, where does it go?
The basin?
Yeah.
Currently, the basin's designed to collect and capture up to the 100-year storm, which is the highest storm that is.
So it's detention area, is it?
It's infiltration. So it's that area that you see, that this dog leg shaped basin is designed to collect all the runoff from the site up to the 100-year storm and then infiltrate it through the ground.
So it literally infiltrates on this site. You're not putting anything out in. And
that's correct. Right. Which is a very conservative design. You know, there is, you know, despite it being lawn area mostly, there is some runoff off site, particularly up in the 100-year storm, but we decided that a good approach was just to collect it.
And you were saying there's 15 feet of sand or 14 feet of sand above a clay layer?
Exactly, yep.
Really?
That's really sandy over there. I dug behind where the chemical place is and across the tracks at John's. Not that deep, but, you know, 8 feet.
Well, we laid a water pipe in the front of the property, and I didn't think it would. I just figured it wasn't sandy, in my estimation. It was just regular dirt, like, you know, like not subsoily sandy. It was more heavy soil. But maybe in the back of the lot it is. I don't know.
Yeah, there's some fairly mature trees back there, and it's high canopy, so you could tell that's probably haven't been touched in quite some time, whereas something on the road, maybe the construction of Elm Street, there was fill brought in. Because if you recall, this site actually depresses, and Route 5 is higher, which is part of one of the one of the things working against us is that just to bring it up to the street grade, you have to bring in 4 feet of compacted fill, so... This has some.
They don't drain it out onto that property, do they? The highway.
What?
They don't drain the 5 and 10 off into that. area, do they?
They do, yeah, the 5 and 10 is not, it's curved to about here, but substantially, 5 and 10, the high point just washes off into this basin.
Oh, okay, but they don't pipe it down there?
It's not piped.
They do up at my property, up further.
No, it goes overland.
They have a 12-inch pipe coming right off the highway into my yard back here.
I can't make out the elevation on the road, is it 203 right along Elm Street?
Yep, 203 right here. Actually, 203 is right here, this is about 2036, 204.
So you're raising that whole site already?
No, no, well, the floor is at 204, that's the floor of the building, and that won't be as high. The parking lot is...
I thought you just said they have to raise it 4 feet to get it to street level.
If they wanted to come up to 5 and 10.
I'd like to raise it more, but based, again, on the geotechnical constraints, this is 204, all of this is about, 201, 200, I'd like, you know, the intersection is 206. So, I'd like to raise it more, but we can't, that's why I'm trying to see...
What was the reason for not being able to raise it?
Cost.
Dollars.
Just the fill?
Well, it's...
No, I think there was something more that I...
It's not even the fill, it's the, every 6 inches or a foot, or every additional vertical, whatever you want to call it, applies additional load on that clay layer, and that equals more settlement over the same period of time, or mitigation processes during construction, basically de-watering during construction.
So, I'm just trying to follow this, so there, your engineers, or you, are saying that if you add 2 or 3 feet of gravel to that area, the added weight of the gravel could affect the clay layer 15 feet below?
I'm not saying that, I'm saying that our geotechnical engineer that is hired by Cumberland Farms, we're the civil, we're not the geotechnical, the environmental, they have given Cumberland Farms direction on the subsurface layers of this property, and given them scenarios of certain heights, whether that building is 204, 205, 206, 207, and has a domino effect of load and displacement across the site. They have determined, Cumberland Farms has determined that 204 is the best elevation for the geotechnical issues that lie on the site.
So, you were kind of getting it, so, I mean, this is the groundwater issue, and then there's the, where's the water going issue?
Yeah, he said it's going to, it's like a leach basin.
Yeah.
And so, obviously, road grit, they have them around town already, and obviously, oil or film will seal that off. It's like your leach field in your septic tank, and certainly that leaching ability, and I don't know how you're going to maintain that or not, or...
Well, there's pre-treatment devices upstream of that. There are, and based on Mr. Newman's report, we're going to be beefing up that pre-treatment. So there are protocols upstream that will capture that oil, capture that grit. And there's a full operation and maintenance plan submitted to that, within the report, that requires inspection and maintenance and cleaning of the various BMPs, the infiltration basin included.
I mean, part of what, like, this is different than some of the other projects we look at. This, we kind of want the building to be lower, and the parking lot to be lower than Elm Street and 5 and 10, right? So water doesn't come out onto town streets.
Well, yeah, or surrounding property.
Right.
But they could slope that all toward that.
Yeah, even if the building were higher, we would not discharge water onto Elm Street or Route 5. There's a ditch here that is the old, I guess, railroad ditch. And all the water wants to go that way. So the only water that is going towards Elm Street is this front lawn area and a very small piece of the driveway, just to get the grading to work. But there's actually less water going there in the proposed than there is in the existing.
And then to the east, whose property over there, is that higher, or is that...
The east, that probably is higher, that's where the parking offices are now, Peter May. I'm quite certain it's higher.
Pretty similar grade.
Yeah, it's somewhat similar.
Yeah.
So you've got berms or something over there.
Yeah, there's just, Actually, in the existing condition, the property line is the midpoint of a swale that is just basically runoff travels along that property line. We're essentially just maintaining that.
No, relatively speaking, you're keeping 100% on the property.
Yeah.
With biomat for treatment.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a very good design.
Yeah, the only hurdle that we have to get over is to provide, we need 7 inches. We need 7 inches.
Anybody got 7 inches?
No, I hear six. No, I hear...
7 inches cheap.
And then south, it's all going to be stopped by all this.
Yeah, it's just going to go to the wetlands. Actually, there's a berm here that there's a what we call an emergency overflow. It's 20-foot wide stone berm. That actually is not going to be used below the 100 year. It's for in the event that something over 100 year at least has a controlled path to get to the wetlands, as opposed to overflowing in all types of directions.
When do you think you'll get a definitive from MassDOT with your curb cut?
Our next step is submitting for direct vehicular access permit. Mm-hmm. Right now, they're in the process of what they call a canvassing process, where it's the process of lifting the no access, and that's currently with the main office in Boston. So once that gets granted, and we thought we would have had something already. We can then submit the direct access permit to get this curb cut.
What happens if that curb cut is denied for whatever reason on Route 5?
And we're not allowed to have any access?
Onto Route 5.
I mean, I guess I'd be speaking a little bit outside my realm of expertise, but I don't think the project would be viable. There's only one.
Well, that's why I'm asking the question.
I mean, that's obviously a business decision,
right?
But my guess would be that it's not a viable project.
And the Elm Street curb cut you already have, or is that
there's actually two, I believe, there now.
But that's not the same as where the house is.
Yeah, there's actually a curb cut. There's an existing curb cut right here, and there's also one right here. So we are lining ours up with the People's Bank, which
okay.
is, you know, good practice, so that there's no conflicting left turns.
But that's also in the permit process as well, too.
Usually local curb cuts, the actual permit itself is picked up by the contractor or the general contractor. And I don't know how it is in this town, and we still need to vet that out. But usually the DPW or the town engineer reviews the design during this process and vets out and comments on any of the design or geometry issues.
The reason I ask is that curb cut is on Elm Street, which is not a state highway, but if I'm not mistaken, the state controls intersections for 150 feet deep. So I just didn't know the fact if you were.
They haven't given us any indication that they are taking jurisdiction over the Elm Street curb cut.
What is the distance, you know, from the intersection, from 5 and 10? Because that is, you don't want it too close, because then you get people whipping around.
The only reason I asked is that subject came up today at another meeting where a party down the road was trying to get the exact same thing, not on there. And the state said that they control access to all intersections, even if it's on a town road for a distance of 150 feet. So
from the leading edge of our proposed curb to the stop bar is about 80 feet.
So that'll be interesting. Who?
Yeah. I don't know.
Who has an issue with that? Could it move further away from the intersection if it had to? Or? probably could help.
Looks like it would mess up the parking down.
Yeah, we typically like to design the access drives that, to match up, or, no, in line with the main access drive here, so it's a convenient and efficient access.
People's, yeah. Is that in the traffic, is that part of the traffic?
I was just gonna ask, you alluded to the fact that there's a traffic study, you're way ahead of me, good work. Yeah, so you did file a traffic study as part of your application?
Yep, yeah, they prepared, McMahon Associates, who's the Cumberland Farms traffic engineer, prepared a traffic study.
And they have one called roadway network, and, well, so that's gonna be, this'll all be covered in here.
And do you know if Mr. Newman has reviewed any of that, or? I don't know if that falls within his area of expertise.
Yeah.
I think this is what we give to you, is it?
No, we can't do traffic studies, you need transportation specialists to review those. So that might be another peer review that you would need to, some expertise that you would need to get from a different engineering firm.
No speed limit is posted on Elm Street, did you know that?
Did you say there's four 20,000 gallon tanks going?
Don't go too fast.
Two 20,000.
Two 20.
Well, this says lots of data, I guess. All right, so we'll bring in someone to help us with this, because that's obviously another big part of the site plan review.
So this looks like it's gonna look like the one in Greenfield on Federal Street?
Yes, our company did not do that, but I've heard that site's similar.
It looks very similar to what I've seen here picture-wise.
The one in Greenfield looks like all their sites?
A fairly colonial design, or New England design, if you will. There's a rendering, there's a full-size rendering here, which gives a little snapshot of the building itself. And I also have elevations, which are in the back of your packets, the last three sheets. This sheet here, A31, will give you the front view facing Route 5 and 10, as well as the side view facing Elm Street, so the two front yards, if you will. Just walking you through this architecture, this elevation. The bottom of the building will have a water table about 2 or 3 feet tall, it's a stone veneer with a stone cap, and the body of the building will be a vinyl siding, like an off-white or a beige vinyl siding. There'd be white trim along the underneath the eaves of the building. This gray hatch here, this is a black and white printout, obviously, is this green this green band. And the ZBA board did not want that, so we are in the process of.
They didn't want the green band?
They didn't want the green. They didn't want the green.
So why did?
What?
Why didn't?
They just didn't think it was in keeping with the town, so.
Really?
And why, do they have, do they have a say on that?
I mean, did you have to ask them, or did they come out and say, we don't like the green?
Well, we had given them the architects give us like a
colored picture.
A colored palette.
It's a special permit, only if you have the right color.
Yeah, that's why I don't sit in that side table. I said, what, do you want a hot pink? I think it looks beautiful like that.
So,
aren't most men colorblind? So the Vegas must have been.
That's why I'm here.
That's why you're here. Yeah, that's what I understand.
Clearly,
and then obviously, as you can see here, there's the roof line will obviously be shingled. It's like a gray or a gray shingle with dormers and gables, just to kind of break up that massing.
Is there a second story in, or are the gables just?
It's unoccupied.
Okay. And you know, storage or office space? Or?
There's actually no storage, it's just completely vacant. There is access to the back of the building, which is where the condensers are.
Yeah, on the little patio like on the back.
So there's internal access as well as access, exterior access from the ladder, there's a gate. But, you know, what Comwood Farms does, you know, I think very nicely is the architecture carries through to the dispensers and the canopy, so that there's a mansard roof on the canopy itself. It's shingled, has that same white fascia board, if you will. There's the stones that, the stone veneer wraps the column supports, and that also carries through to the pylon sign as well. The planter is housed in that same stone veneer. And the outdoor.
How far is the other, what is the plans for the other site?
The other site would be closed, and the tanks and all the environmental issues will be removed and cleaned up in accordance with state regulations, and the site would be deed restricted for gas or convenience, and it would look to be sold.
So I want to come back to that. Thank you for answering that. I didn't know if that's your in your purview or not. Because we do have some. Yeah, we do. We need, as a town, we need to talk about that. But I wonder if we can just go over quickly. So that our site plan review. So you've talked a lot about things here. Existing building structure, fences. So the only fence is the one in the back.
Yeah.
And that's 6 foot solid white solid fence.
Opaque. Yep. 6 foot high opaque.
In loading areas, where's deliveries and things? Do they come in the front?
So the loading area would take place right here in this berth, if you will, right in front of the enclosure. There's a ramp here.
That's the trash removal.
Dumpster.
Yep.
And then they get wheeled in on pallets through that rear door.
Excuse me. No trucks in the back.
No trucks in the back. Right, no, the truck would sit here.
Set it in front of the business.
How far is the back of the building from that sideline, the east sideline?
About 25 feet. Mm-hmm. So it's good distance.
And snow removal.
There should be. So snow storage is located, if you look on 4.0, unlike most sites, this is one of the sites, the very few sites that we actually have a lot of area to use, and there's a lot of grass area. And this is one of the few sites where we actually can provide an above ground basin, which is always preferred over anything subsurface. So we are, the idea is to load the snow on the southerly edge of the site so that when it melts, it can go through that proper treatment train and infiltrate into the ground.
And you have clear, everything can be pushed that direction. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. That basin is like maybe 10 or 15 feet off the edge of the southerly curb line. So there is plenty of space here to load that snow.
And utilities are all
probably on the ground. Yep. Yeah. Utilities. Sheet 7.0 is the utilities. Basically, much of the service penetrations to the new building come out the back here. Or the side, and then we're tying them all off of Elm Street. And that being electric, gas, and sewer. Actually, sewer has an existing stub that we were told by the owner, and we also discovered that on site, so we can actually tie on site. We don't have to go into the street for the sewer. We do have to go into the street for the water, and as you know, there's no gas, although we've been told that there's a future line coming.
Yeah.
So we've made provisions for propane.
Where do you keep that?
The propane will be in the back here on sheet 7.0. It has a dashed area, designated area for a proposed tank.
Oh yeah, right here on the middle of the building on the back.
That's far enough from the property line.
Yeah, it only needs to be 10 feet.
Yeah, 10. It's 10 feet from the building, 10 feet from the property line.
Yeah. There's gas main in Elm Street.
They've got the line running right out there, but not hooked up.
Oh, you know what it was? There was a, I think there's a moratorium on connections.
Yep, there is.
Yeah, because they don't have enough capacity at this point.
Yeah, I think that'll change soon, though.
So you've got parking, what about walkways along Elm Street there? You got sidewalks?
There's sidewalks along Elm Street. We're proposing new sidewalks along Elm Street. That was a request, I believe, actually from DOT, because they wanted to introduce a crosswalk here.
Oh, good.
In a landing area. So they said, consider bringing sidewalk across the street. We currently don't have sidewalk connection from the street to Cumberland Farms. I guess that's something that we could entertain. It's mostly a vehicular-oriented use, but, you know, perhaps, if I'm understanding you correctly, perhaps introduction to a sidewalk.
We've done a lot downtown over the, well, we've done some of downtown over the past few years.
Nothing on Sugarloaf Street.
And we have a complete streets plan for what we envision downtown to be, and includes much more sidewalks, you know, bike rideability kind of thing. You know, Cumberland Farms right now gets, you know, high school kids going in there for sodas. So, you know, where do they walk? And I think if we're going to, if this is part of the Deerfield neighborhood still, then we need that. Otherwise, it's part of the
train tracks really miss it.
Is it part of the Route 91 neighborhood, or is it part of the Deerfield neighborhood? And that's a question that I think a lot of us have. And I think that whole intersection is something that, you know, we've always wanted to be more attractive. And so as people drive down, they know there's a downtown there. Were you with the sign meeting the other night? I understand that the sign, there was some discussion about having on Cumberland's property signage for downtown South Deerfield businesses.
Yes, okay. Yes, so that was part of our sign package. And that town sign is located here. It's proposed to be here.
So good visibility from 91 going north?
Yep.
Route 5.
From Route 5, yeah.
Yep.
So I think that's we're trying to see what benefits, so that this isn't just a, people could off go to Cumberland's and get out of there, but they know there's something behind it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so perhaps we can take a look at an internal sidewalk connection. Probably makes sense to do something in this vicinity right here.
Or
even down closer to closer downtown.
Okay.
You know, cut right through, because everybody's going to walk through the grass anyway.
So. The east side of the property.
The desire line. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, that then at least pretends to have a connection to downtown.
Yep.
So will the sidewalk get built, or is that just something that they're thinking about?
The sidewalks?
Yeah.
No, that would be constructed as part of the project.
Because we have an existing water main that's in that grass belt.
Yes.
And so I work for the water supply,
yeah.
And I'm concerned that we put it in the grass belt so we'd have easier access. So I just like to know where the walk would be.
Yeah. So we had you know, during our due diligence, we've identified there's an easement obviously associated with that. So what we did do is, and when we introduced the sidewalk, we had notified DOT and our client that perhaps another easement may be required. Or the existing water easement may need to be updated. But what we did is we located any signs outside of that easement so that there's just flat.
I'm not saying you can't. I just didn't. If you could locate it so it's not right directly on top of it, it'd be a good thing. But if that can't be, well, need to be discussed. That's all I'm
saying. You're talking about a sidewalk that's not here.
Right.
That would come across the yard. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, the easement is located, like it should.
I just wanted you to be aware of it.
Yes.
I saw that on your plans. It shows the existing water line and stuff.
Yeah, we
and it would
we
be
are,
a concern to us, that's
yeah,
all.
Yeah, no, we are aware of it. So that 16-inch line is coming right through here, and your easement is right in here. So that sidewalk only clips a little bit of that easement right here.
Yeah,
so we wanted to make sure we keep it out. Any farther out would then reduce the lane width in Elm Street. We wanted to keep that curb line the same.
Oh yeah.
So yeah, I mean like everything, it's a balance. It's a balance.
Right.
The other quick things, I'm just picking up our, obstruction from going from the entrances and exits. You've got plenty of room there for...
Yeah, there's no site distance.
There's no site problems with that.
Can the trains stop traffic up? How far from the track?
That's a good question.
I did not look at that. I guess I can get that answer for you.
What do they call the...
Amtrak?
The Amtrak, that's not a problem, but the freight trains, and they back up traffic. I just wonder how far they'll back up the traffic into the...
That should be, that'd be a good thing to have in here.
Yeah, that would be great if that's addressed in the traffic study, and if not, that's the first question to be put to them, right? That's a really good...
Because I've seen the traffic back up quite a bit there.
John, talking about the sidewalk here.
When there's a freight train going through.
There's a sidewalk on the other side, and there's a crosswalk over. There's nothing here on this side, so this almost might be detrimental to have that.
Well, but he said DOT's talking about a sidewalk across Elm, because there's no crosswalk here?
I thought it's over here is where they're talking.
Would you say DOT wants to put a sidewalk?
On Elm Street.
A crosswalk across.
Across Elm Street, yeah.
Okay.
So that, the town should actually say whether we want it or not.
Well, there's no sidewalk on the other side of the...
There is a sidewalk in front of the bank.
Not in front of the bank, is there?
There's a sidewalk there, but there's no cross...
On 510, though?
But that's why I brought it up, because that's the only side where there's a crosswalk on the highway, is on the north side.
So the crosswalk would be for Elm Street and not for 5 and 10?
No, it's...
Well, there is a crosswalk on 5 and 10.
What I'm getting at is that if they want the crosswalk here...
Right.
What is it servicing? A sidewalk coming this way?
I guess.
There's nothing that way.
Right.
Yeah, so the sidewalk that runs, like, we'll say, east and west.
Right, it's just for the people that live on Elm Circle.
Well, that's on Elm Street. But north and south on 5 and 10, there's no...
There's no sidewalk.
From Doc Schmidt's to People's Bank, there's a...
Crosswalk.
Crosswalk there.
Okay, well, that's what I was asking. So it's, yeah.
You lived here your whole life. You should know that.
I heard that. I didn't live my whole life.
So a question is whether... Is there any... Does the town want there to be the connection from Yankee Candle to this Cumberland's, like down on that?
But I think that's the whole concept. They get the people over on this side.
Yeah.
You know, so everybody crosses right there.
Right, but now Cumberland's would rather have them cross here and go with it,
Well, I don't think they're creating a crosswalk here. They're just going to do it and then have one right across the entrance to Elm.
I'm just saying, people don't walk that way.
Yeah. People walk the shortest distance.
Exactly, so we should plan for that instead of being surprised by it. That's a DOT issue, I guess, where the crosswalk. So, Patricia, have you looked at this before?
I have not seen anything until this evening.
So we need to make a plan then.
Right.
I think is our next step. So we open a public hearing tonight. So I see 300 abutters within 300 feet, I guess, things were sent out to. It's a very short list, but I guess part of that's just the way it's situated.
No, going north. There's not a lot of different properties.
So is there anybody here that has questions about this?
I just have a question.
Yeah.
You say that the...
Are you in a butter?
No.
You didn't receive a...
Do we have to get a sign-up sheet? I didn't see one.
Here's a sign-up sheet, actually. You to sign that before you go.
The entrance on the Elm Street is going to be across from the People's Savings Bank. Is it the entrance to People's Savings Bank?
Or the exit?
The entrance, not the exit.
The westerly one, the exit.
The one closest to 5 and 10.
Yeah, well, that's an exit. That's only an exit going out. Yeah. Entrance is further to the east. If you go against the traffic, you can go in that way.
80 feet. 80 feet.
I had given him my card.
Yeah,
sir.
Perfect.
So,
his card here, I go.
Yeah,
okay.
Oh, okay, and then I need Pat. So we have when was this received? Let me see. November 8th.
On the front, it's stamped November 4th. These plans, is that what you're asking?
Oh, yeah, site plan application came in November 5th. That's funny. This came in November.
The application came in November 4th, and this is the first.
I believe there was an administrative glitch on November 5th and 6th, because we did have a meeting on the 7th, and apparently this was here, but it wasn't on our agenda, so we didn't even know about it.
Funny how that happens.
It wasn't on our agenda.
Yeah. It wasn't, we knew it was coming. We knew it was coming, but we weren't aware of it. But, so we're already, a month into this, and it's 90 days, I think. Is that when we want to? Pat, you haven't done your full chart yet.
I have to look at the site plan review chart. It's a little bit different. Obviously, they're in the process of making additional changes, so you don't even have the final site plan that you're going to review. So I'm sure under the circumstances, if, you know, timeframe needs to go on, the applicant would be willing to request a continuance in order to stay the clock so that we don't end up getting stuck there.
Will this be a 24-hour store?
Good question. That's currently the proposal. And usually what Cumberland Farms does in that situation is they let the market determine. I believe.
I don't think it won't be that way for long.
No. The one down in town is not 24 hours.
Yeah.
It's 18 or 16. And it opens at 6 and it closes at what? I don't know what time 11? It closes.
11, I think.
Yeah.
And who gives that? Is that a special permit?
Usually that comes.
That'd be a condition of the special permit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that was the other question I had about trucks. So yeah. Is this for diesel trucks? You have diesel, so how big of a truck can be in and out of there?
For consumers, like for patrons?
Yeah.
Not for delivery vehicles.
No. Sorry, I'm okay. Talking about, can tractor trailers get in and get diesel?
No. No, they can't fit. And it's not designed to do that. Yeah.
And the reason they wouldn't is because they pump slow, and that's why they'd go to the trucks.
If somehow the tractor trailer would get in here and pump, that's the last time they'll be, because it only pumps at 5 gallons a minute, where they're used to at 50 gallons a minute.
So.
But no, they're not sized or designed to maneuver in and out that site.
And is that, I mean, I don't know about trucking, is that clear for all trucks? Because it'd be convenient for them to get off 91, go north, get here, get gas, get back on.
I think they'll figure it out real quick when they look at it.
You might be able to get a horse in there, but you'd never get a trailer and a horse in there. It never happened.
So planning board has 60 days from the filing date to take final action and file a written decision. Unless the site plan review is part of a special permit application, in which case special permit procedures and plan timetable 90 days apply. So did this go for the special permit at the same time? Probably.
For the ZBA?
Yeah.
Yes.
On the 4th of November?
No, on the 1st of December. We were in front of them on Thursday. Is that what you're asking, Mr. Chair?
Yeah, but I think you must have filed it with them on November 4th.
Oh, yeah. We filed it earlier. I think the filing was done on the same day for planning and ZBA.
December, January. All right, so February 4th, about.
And depending on how long this process takes.
Right.
It is likely, you know, given the number of reviews that we're discussing, that there probably would need to be an extension of time.
Yep.
Right.
For that. And your site plan review report needs to go to CONCOM, so that can be incorporated into their special permit.
All right, and some of CONCOM's reports have to come to us.
Right, so there's a whole
it's a back and forth.
Yeah,
and then the whole and then the ZBA thing. But you said they closed their meeting.
Yeah, we're meeting with them on the 15th, provided that we give them information that they've asked for.
It's a little bit tricky there, but they have different.
When we were speaking about tractor trailers, deliveries actually, and I know downtown there's maybe smaller trailers and bigger trailers, and sometimes it's inconvenient with traffic and stuff, so this place would be maybe even harder. I mean, there's an intersection downtown. How do they propose their deliveries?
The deliveries are easier, so they do deliver with a tractor trailer.
Right.
So they'll come into the site, and they...
Then back in.
Well, if you actually look on 4.0, there's a truck turn movement, and it's actually on this plan here. This tractor trailer is sitting at this at an angle, parallel with the tanks.
Yeah.
And they'll load on the right-hand side in
for
a protected fashion.
Stuff.
For the fuel, and then they'll come out.
Yeah, I was figuring off. That's what they would do. But how about, like, you know, other soda or whatever they get, you know?
Oh, they'll back into this berth over here.
They'll be straight jobs, or will they be tractor, because a lot of times there are.
Some of the larger Cumberland farms is the same WB-50, a tractor trailer size, but most of it is box, like the vendors.
The one in center of town is tractor trailer.
Yeah, it all depends. Their own product will come in tractor trailer, and they'll back into that berth. But not the fueling truck.
Right, right.
And then they'll be like the soda truck or the milk truck or whatever.
That's what I was looking at. If you have both those entrances or exits, whatever you want to call them, yeah, there probably wouldn't be an issue with a tractor trailer.
No, and again, this is one of the sites, unique sites, where all the loading is pretty much separate from the site.
Yeah.
And that's why there's a design such as the new gas stations are going to, the dispensers are perpendicular to the convenience store, so you have access, vehicular access for patrons on both sides, and you're not dependent on the guy in front of you or the guy behind you to get in and out of your space.
I want to make sure I heard you correctly. Now, leaving Cumberland, going onto Elm Street, you will not be able to take a left turn. That's no left turn, correct?
Onto Elm?
No.
No, it's 5 and 10. Just 5 and 10.
Just 5 and 10.
Yeah, so if you want to go south, you have to use the Elm Street access and make a left at all.
And that was, did DOT say that, or that was, you just knew that was a better way to go?
That was DOT.
Okay.
We asked, would they consider full access, and they said no. And we didn't think it was.
Coming across, because I figure what this.
It's wide there. It's, you know, it's 3 lanes going north, 1 lane south, but it's a very wide.
Yeah, it goes a lot.
I mean, the right in, right out is the right move there. The left out, I think, would be
a catastrophe.
Chaos, dangerous. Yeah. But even left out where it is on Elm Street,
right,
people coming around, taking a right onto Elm Street, it's a short distance there. So that's why interesting.
I misunderstood him at the beginning. That's what he was talking about. It made sense.
I was always under the impression where that curb line, like, they're responsible, or they had a say in where the curb cut could be. And there's curbing, I think, more than 80 feet. So I would think the state would be involved in that decision. But I'm just guessing.
So is that, can you double check that?
I can.
Whether they are going to be responsible or not, or what they might say.
I'll make some inquiries on that. So you said it's 150 feet, Kip, that was what you heard of the intersection?
And when you heard that information, was somebody reliable, Kip, or?
Yeah, just from the state.
Okay, I didn't know.
Down the district too. I can't think of his name. I was reading it. I think his name is John Foley.
So I guess what I would suggest our next step would be to continue this public hearing until our next meeting, when we'll have more information. And Rachel's looking up when the next CONCOM meeting is, because they'll have more discussion about
it. Do you have a meeting with them?
You might know.
December 22nd.
The 22nd?
22nd.
So it's the third Thursday. Yeah, they meet Thursdays.
Is it the third? I think it's still the fourth.
I just looked, sorry.
Well, this 21
December,
days is 3 weeks.
You know, it was weird.
Days is 3 weeks, so that's one day over that.
Yeah, but the
that.
First is a Thursday, was Thursday, so it's actually the fourth Thursday, December 22nd.
22nd, okay, that's what I have. And you have them, you know that they're meeting then?
That's what we discussed. It was continued to this from the October meeting, because the November 17th meeting was too close.
Yep.
And this is a meeting of the CONCOM?
Yes, CONCOM.
However, given the timing and the fact that we haven't revised the plans because we wanted to get feedback from ZBA and Planning Board, perhaps we can make our changes by the 22nd and submit to Conservation, but obviously I can't speak for a review agent reviewing it during that time frame. So, you know, that meeting still may go on to give the commission an update, but there may not be any feedback from, you know, I'm just thinking as far as timing.
And it may put us out to January then. You know,
And we're trying to figure out if we can consolidate any meetings or something like that. But I think it is better them do their thing with their engineer, and we'll get that report then. And then at our next planning board meeting, we'll review that, and we'll review the ZBA. We'll have met already again.
But will we need a peer review?
Well, that's what we need to decide. What do we need peer reviews of? What can our consultant Pat do? And then we need to get some estimates.
Right, so if you want me to give you an estimate for what does the zoning compliance review would be, I can get that to you shortly within the week.
Planning board.
That'd be great.
And then the traffic study, could one of your people look at that?
No, we don't have specific engineers that do that analysis anymore.
So who does that around here?
So that typically would be through one of the larger engineering firms. We would also have traffic engineering components. So I can talk with Dick and see, you know, who you may have used in the past, so that there's a history.
Yeah, I mean, then we should talk about whether we think that's necessary. I mean,
I would think that the state is going to be more involved with the curb cuts, and they know the traffic more than we're going to know.
But on 5 and 10, anyway.
I think they'd know both.
They got Elm Street down pat, too.
Yeah? All right.
I would think.
Let's see what they come up with.
I mean, you know, we have a question in regard to their jurisdiction there to begin with, so I can just make a point of contacting DOT directly and, you know, clarify what they would have jurisdiction over, and then that can help inform you as to what kind of additional expertise you think you might need.
And I'll also let our traffic.
The second, then?
What's that?
Would our next meeting be on the second, or then? Or?
Is that the first Monday?
Yeah.
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 Okay.
And I'll let our traffic engineer know that, I'm sure he does know that, if that's true, DOT has jurisdiction within 150 feet, then I'm sure he's aware of that. And they've been talking with DOT for over a year now, so.
This is McMahon, you mean?
McMahon.
Yeah.
So the deed restriction for the existing Cumberland Farms, will that stipulate no gas, or will it stipulate no convenience store? Because right now, that is, believe it or not, it's like a core to the center of town. Mm-hmm. The kids, the high school kids, grammar school kids, I mean, they go there for whatever, you know, and that's going to leave the center of town.
That's going to be a holiday.
Without anything.
Yeah.
Am I right? Yeah, I think.
Yeah, I guess I can't speak for anything beyond gas. They typically do restrict gas. As far as convenience items and food items and food-related items, I do not know, actually, about that.
We should also be a little bit quick on that, because that could instantly become a new pot store. We have an overlay district for medical marijuana.
You won't fire to go for lunch.
Now that it's legal, they can sell drugs right out of there tomorrow.
That's
well,
right.
Well, not right after the 15th they can, so.
And also the second is the observed holiday I see on my calendar here.
Oh, for New Year's?
Yeah.
Oh, I was trying to think.
So does that mean the 9th then?
9th.
If the town hall's closed, then we tend not to have meetings.
Yes.
Look at that at my house.
Yeah, it says that the 2nd is the observed holiday.
Yeah, that's probably when people get the day off.
Okay.
Yep.
So, Mr. Chairman, if I may, I'm looking at the bottom of page 179-71, which is site plan review procedures 5421.
Yeah.
And that very last sentence there says the planning board shall review and act upon the site plan with such conditions as may be deemed appropriate within 60 days of its receipt.
And then, but that's when I said if there's an application for a special permit, in which case special permit procedures and timetable 90 days apply. I'm looking at the chart.
Oh, okay. Well, just to be mindful that we may need a continuance.
Yeah.
Especially if the January meeting goes later.
You mean the 9th?
You might need a continuation before then to have been signed for the 4th. Avoid the constructive grant. So, yeah, it's.
But what?
So, we.
If we're all willing to meet on the 2nd, we could. I mean, there's no.
No, the building's not open.
The building's not open.
Yeah,
I got a key.
I mean, not that we can.
It's not the key.
Kip's a high monkey.
It's an observed holiday, so it's.
Yeah,
it's
I don't know if we're supposed to.
Anything that would be closed for a holiday would be closed at that day.
And especially for a public hearing, I don't think we can do that on another.
Right.
Probably not.
It's
true.
Okay. We could do it Tuesday night. I mean,
yeah,
we
could do the 3rd.
We could do Wednesday. Yeah, Tuesday or Wednesday, but.
We could do the 3rd. I mean, that's just to be.
Because then, so then we also need to get letters from the police, the fire. Have you know if the fire's chimed in yet?
Not to my knowledge, no, but the goal would be to get that before the December 15th ZBA hearing. So if we have it then, you'd obviously be CC'd or we'd forward it to you.
And his state fire marshals must be involved in gas stations too?
Not yet, though. So after we go through the land use permits, ZBA, CONCOM, planning, then we have to file with the Board of Selectmen for the UST license.
Oh,
and preceding that, though, that's when we submit our plans to the fire department.
Okay.
And they work in consultation with the state as well.
What's the UST license?
Underground storage tank.
Oh. Acronyms are going to kill me.
So it's the Board of Selectmen that does it in here?
I believe that's the case.
Typically,
the towns, the boards do it, the cities, city councils do it. That's what I recall in this town.
All right, so let's try to stick to this early January meeting then.
So January 2nd or 9th?
Well, how can we all?
I can do the
3rd. I mean, not the 2nd, the 3rd then would be good.
The Tuesday, 3rd would be all right.
It's early, okay
with me?
Yeah, that's fine.
Ours is on the 4th.
My son's having his good
view. I think I have a commitment on the 3rd too, so.
My son's having his wisdom teeth out.
If we still got a quorum, that's fine.
I could do that still.
His birthday. He's having his wisdom teeth out for his birthday. Oh, that's good.
All right, so January 3rd, Roger?
Hope I'm here.
I think I have a commitment. I'll check and see what I'm doing.
I mean, I might have a birthday party. Man, I just thought he's gone. All right. Come in. Bye.
7 o'clock, or do you want to do it earlier?
Ooh, that'd be nice.
No, I would have a hard time getting here just at 7.
But 7 is fine.
I get my
other That's okay.
I'm in.
2017 is the first time I wrote it.
God, that works. That could work for you.
Yes, it does.
So before that, though, so what do we need? I'm trying to make a little shopping list here.
Thank you. So we need an estimate from Pat about the zoning issues.
So the zoning compliance review,
zoning
what
compliance
that will cost. Get some information from MassDOT about their authority and what additional traffic review expertise you may require.
Yeah, if they can review the traffic impact study, we agree. Then we'll get.
What about CONCOM? We'll have their.
We'll get the environmental engineering report from Newman after CONCOM.
Okay. Yeah.
And that'll be might just be new in 22nd of December, but by the 3rd it might be.
Yeah.
Newman might have responded to it. Well, no.
So that's a terrible time to ask people to be sitting reading. Reviewing report.
CONCOM, though, and uh-huh.
And then if any letters that the ZBA doesn't get from other town officials, we'll need to have too, from fire police, DPW. Mm-hmm. Anything on the Board of Health on this?
No, I think we looked at it and didn't have any comments at the time.
And then our attorney needs to write a continuation letter.
Mm-hmm. That'd be great. It sounds like it's going to.
That'd be helpful.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're not going to start construction until April anyway, right? I mean, you need to know what's going on.
We obviously want to work with the town.
Yeah, we'll keep moving.
And get collective approval.
And so you could just request the continuation, you know, until that next meeting, and then that we would keep doing that.
Yeah. Tom Reedy is familiar
I'm
with.
Sure he probably has a form that he uses. If not, we can create one.
And we don't need to post this again. As a public hearing, it just
remains open. But that's why you ask for the continuation to a date certain and follow with town clerk. So if anyone has a question, they can figure that out easily by contacting officials.
All right, one other question. Cumberland's never does beer and wine, do they?
They do in some stores. Yeah. This isn't. I think there's like when you have multiple stores, there's a restriction on
how many
per state. So to my knowledge, this is not one of those stores.
Mm-hmm.
And this will be strictly Cumberland Farms. They're not going to rent spaces out like Circle K or.
Yeah, no, they own and operate their own.
No, but I mean, like, will there be other vendors in there?
Yeah, but there won't be a Dunkin' Donuts there, right?
No.
That's my question.
Yes.
Okay, there's two questions going on here.
What is important?
That's the important one.
What was the important one then, John?
The dollars.
Well, it'd still be Cumberland Farms coffee, so you walk in, buy a coffee and get out instead of waiting. And
so there won't be other vendors.
I wonder if they're parking that dollar store truck there just to get us prepared for it.
What's that?
Have you seen that truck down there next to Leader that says dollar store?
I think there's a trucker that lives close by.
Next to.
Yeah.
They've been looking for a place in town for a dollar store.
No.
Yeah.
All right, I think we've got a plan. You have any other questions for us?
No, I think that's it. I think the shopping district you create, I think that's what I had, so just so I can relay all the messages back.
I don't think it's.
All right, but they, again, so, you know, water is a big one, so we'll be following through with DEP and the Concom on that one.
Excellent.
And then the signage, I'm curious about that. That's I guess, a special permit from the ZBA. And that color scheme is interesting, why they weighed in on that one.
Yeah, right.
I think Deerfield Red would look good.
Yeah, red potatoes.
All right, anything else? No? All right, we'll see you on the third then, if not before.
Third, yeah.
And you'll.
Tuesday.
And actually, if you can prep your colleagues there, that we will want to talk more about the other building. Maybe we'll try to have
some. Thank you for coming.
The existing site?
The existing site.
Oh, okay. Yep.
About what plans are and things like that. Or I don't know, is that, well, we should weigh in on the planning board, but the select board might also.
No, I agree. I mean, this is huge for the center of town, this leaving.
Yeah, and if they said you could have no food there, that's a problem.
Right.
You know, so they.
No, I think the restrictions are no gas station, no convenience store. I mean, it could still be.
But why would the town not want to have a convenience store?
I don't think the town can.
Well, I think we need to discuss it.
Can't dictate what they can. They can put any restrictions they want on it. They own the property.
Right, and the town can make any request.
Well, yeah, I know, John. I'm not arguing, but I'm just saying. Yeah.
No, everybody's trying to be good neighbors.
No, I understand where you're coming from.
Nowhere for the kids.
You don't want it there just to be a nothing.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Because they can't walk in the package store.
Yeah, no, I'm going to send an email. I'm sure.
No, absolutely.
So.
21 now.
Great.
What's that?
It's 21 now.
Well, I didn't know whether you could
walk in.
All right, thank you.
You're back.
So next up, Grandview Estates.
Do you want to keep all of these things together?
I hope you enjoyed that discussion. Sorry it took a while.
No, actually, I've been seeing a lot of
it's always
nice to see what's going
on. You'll know more than he does, huh?
What's that?
You'll know more than he does now.
Just for a minute.
You can take it home with you if you want.
No, I don't want it.
I feel if we take them home. Exactly.
Yeah, I'm going to take mine, though.
Oh, you can take yours.
You'll actually use it.
I will use it.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea.
Is there someone else you might want to?
Yeah. We'll have them here to pass out next time.
Exactly. We all take them home.
I can really
never come back.
That's
right.
All right. So now we go to our next pile. Didn't I say?
Have a good night.
Another pile.
No,
night.
Thank you.
Night.
The only thing you likely have in front of you at this point is the Mylar copy of the brand new States modified AP.
This two Mylars here. No.
It's a continuation of one.
Oh, I see.
It takes two sheets for everything they did, at least.
Yeah, three.
Well, I just basically want to flip those things.
You don't exist yet.
Thank you. Attorney Reedy, the reason he's not here tonight, his wife just had their first child, so he's enjoying the first few nights of fatherhood. I'm sure very little sleep.
All right. So what's your name?
My name is David Burson. Also here from Bacon Wilson.
You signed in and you were here. All right.
I kept looking at you going, you're so familiar.
Yeah, we've seen you.
There.
From the kitchen. From the kitchen.
Did I go to school with him? My son.
So we made some headway, I think, the last time. So now we're on to the final.
I don't see the Mylar.
Yes,
it's right out here. It's laid up.
So if you recall, last time we were here, as a brief summation, there was an APP plan filed in 2004. We were seeking to modify that plan. We were looking to combine two of the five lots on the site the lots 1 and 2 to create a larger, about 6.2-acre lot. In the process, we were also seeking to move the cul-de-sac about 60 feet south, as well as reduce the radius of that cul-de-sac from 80 to 60 feet, which was still, there was concern with respect to the that radius, but that radius is actually still what the bylaw requires. I believe the last that we were, the last hearing, the board for the most part was amenable to that plan. I believe that the, at this point we were, and correct me if I'm wrong, I was under the impression that we were adjourning to tonight for the purpose of essentially waiting a month before signing the plan. I wasn't fully sure on the reasoning behind that, but.
I can't remember either.
So that was, Mr. Chairman,
yes.
In so regard to providing for an appeal period.
Oh, okay.
There's a period wherein you approve the subdivision and then you allow some time frame for that appeal to proceed, and then there being no appeal, then it's
gotcha.
Open for endorsement. So there had been a certificate of decision, which I believe the chair had signed and which was sent to
correct.
You and should have been sent to abutters as well, so that they were aware of the appeal period. And then presumably town clerk should have asserted that there is no appeal that has been filed, if you have a letter or something to that effect.
These are the abutters.
These are the abutters, but this looks like the ones.
Those would have been the initial.
That would have been the initial. Yeah.
Correct.
Typically, the notice wouldn't be sent out certified.
Who would have notified the clerk of that?
Well, that all went out in the email. So, unfortunately, right. With the lack of administrative capacity.
Our last meeting was November 7th, and then on November 10th, we sent a letter.
To the town clerk.
To the town clerk.
And to the applicant. And I'm not sure how much further that.
Planning board hereby certifies that an open meeting duly noticed November 7th, planning board voted to approve the modifications to the definitive subdivision plan as presented. And then.
Have any of you been served with court papers? If the answer is no, then there hasn't been an appeal.
Then we're good to go.
I know this.
I apologize, I wasn't at this last meeting. I remember this subdivision a little bit. I don't believe it's a town road now, right?
No, actually, one of the restrictions on the initial plan was that it never become a town road.
Yeah, and I didn't know if it was even built to town specs. That was my next question.
I believe a portion of it was there was that last, I think the marker 13, after that point, it all becomes trap rock as opposed to asphalt.
So the grade, they met the town grade.
It's all right.
Yeah, the first part of it meets the town.
Which is why they did not want it to be paved after that point.
Yeah, okay. I just,
that was prior.
I remember a little of it, but.
Yeah, there was a fence built here and all kinds of stuff for the fire department.
The railing at the bottom of the.
Well, there was guardrails. I think
right,
they sort of
yeah.
met the grade, but they didn't do the whole thing for whatever reason.
My memory says there was 20-some stipulations
in that.
It was
agreement. Clerk's office.
That's what my.
Yeah. I can remember the person.
I remember very well. He's the reason that I'm on the board of.
Pat,
is that the letter that you sent?
Yes.
You said, and John had signed that, and it went to.
That was my understanding. Yes.
It did go to the town clerk. Now, whether it went out to abutters, I didn't follow.
How did it go to the town clerk?
It went by email.
Email.
We know one
after
abutter.
You signed it. I believe it
yep.
was sent as a PDF.
Yep.
Back.
Okay.
Does that go back there?
Yeah, that's
yeah. Right. Give it back. I just
Max
will have the
butter.
Unsigned version, but it did seem like the initial stages, where they did follow through on what needed to be done. I suspect if there had been an appeal filed and those papers brought to the town clerk, they would have been.
They generally,
to you here at the
I understand
board.
What I want to check to make sure that something happened with this
yeah.
if she ever notified the abutters. You know, because I don't want.
I mean, typically, my understanding is that if there's a.
Is this the grand
my understanding of the way the process works is once it's been approved, at that point, if there is an appeal period within that 20 days, they will then notify, the appeal will come to the clerk. And at that point...
So the clerk doesn't have to notify?
Correct, no. The clerk will be notified if there's an appeal, because they'll...
Yeah, I don't think the butters were notified that we voted okay.
Correct. Once they're notified of the initial, hearing and whatnot, that's their notice. They're officially on notice at that point that there is a proceeding.
Right, it's up to them.
And it's up to them to follow through at that point.
As far as you know, this was sent to the town clerk.
Yes. That part I'm...
So I think we're good.
Confident occurred.
I am confident that occurred. So then here we are to basically endorse...
Sign it.
I would like to make a motion to endorse the plan with the modifications from the original Grandview Estates.
Correct. The original plan, I believe, was approved in 2004.
Right. With the reduction of the cul-de-sac, the movement of it, the removal of a lot line.
Right.
So that's my motion.
This is the motion right here.
I'll second.
That's the action that was taken.
Okay.
So it's voted to approve the modification. This is a vote to...
No, that's already been done. That's right. So what you need to do is just simply endorse it.
Endorse it, okay, okay.
You've already voted your approval. It's just a question of...
Motion to endorse.
John just made a motion to endorse it.
Yeah.
So with this endorsement, does this mean that the property owners are going to be able to make a sale on this?
That's the plan. That's the hope. That is the hope. Everybody's got their fingers crossed. So the sale, if you recall, the sale of this property was contingent upon us receiving approval.
Right.
And if the sale does not go through, we have no plans.
This won't be filed.
This will not be filed, right.
Oh, right, that's right, because you don't want to rope yourselves in.
Exactly.
All right, so John made a motion to endorse. Do we have a second?
Kip seconded.
I second it.
Any other further discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain?
600.
600.
All we do is sign it?
Yep.
Now, that's technically, if it isn't filed for whatever reason, it goes away after a year, right?
I believe the original plan will stay in place.
The original plan will stay in place.
Correct. Will just stay in place.
Yeah, that's the one that's filed with the registry.
But how long can you hold this off? That's...
I think it's a year.
I think it might be two.
Might be more than that. I think, yeah.
I think it might be 2 years.
And then I think you actually have the option to come back in and...
Correct. At that point, we'd have to come back and kind of... We'd certainly have to go through the notice provisions again.
It's our two or one.
Two sheets. Splits right down the middle, north-south. East-west is the mark.
Yeah, I don't see anybody here that must be interested in... Unfortunately, I was not able to make it to the site visit because I was out of town. I'd be interested to hear what happened with that.
I never saw
it. We'll discuss it.
What's that?
I never saw it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, baby.
Well, you should probably put your...
Oh, it was pretty heated, was it?
No.
No.
You need more signatures down there?
Yes.
Yes, we will in a minute.
I'm going to bring my easy chair from home. I was here for 3 hours today, tonight, and I'll be here tomorrow. Oh,
yeah.
You need a sleeper sofa. No easy chair.
Miracle lounge, whatever they call it.
A little yoga.
Today's 12.
You and Donald.
Huh?
You and Donald.
Donald.
Trump, I'm just... Oh.
I was called that at one meeting. I really was.
Stop it.
Yes. The guy called me back and apologized.
Good.
I told him I wasn't insulted.
Yeah. Well, you know what's funny? You do those jumbles? The day after the election, they had a thing about ghosts in there, and one of them looked like Donald Trump. Did you get both of them?
I did.
Okay. All right. How many more? Is that it? Is that it?
Enough.
More?
Do we need more?
Yeah, there's four.
Need four.
Four should do it.
We'll take as many as we can get.
Go down.
Well, that's why we're...
Yeah, it was funny. The ghost had this
John covers his
funny hairdo.
It's in the hair thing.
That's it. 2 months.
One wonders.
So there aren't even any more lines.
So do we get... What do we...
Nothing.
They must have gave some at the
there
last
were,
meeting.
There were plans filed originally. I actually have, if you'd like, I've got more in my car. I think I've got 5 or 6 copies.
Well, typically, the building inspector and the planning board.
Barry might want those to start a fire.
They were originally. Right.
Trump support. Yeah. Changed from what you
no, no, no. You, actually, you guys have held the Mylar for the right. Would you like me to grab the other copies?
As long as there are others in the building for the people that need them, then that would be fine.
I mean, I may as well. They are here now, so
paper ones, or
if you don't mind waiting 5 minutes. They're large scale paper ones.
Yeah, we get those signed, and you'll have everything if you need it.
Yeah, there should be a sign set kept here. Yes.
Also, that didn't get done at the other because this is official.
I guess
not.
Yeah.
Okay, there.
All right, A&R reviews none. Subdivision, two-family senior residential plan, 67 Sugarloaf. So it says that we might get a progress report on a MEPA site visit report.
No, I don't want.
I thought we might have.
Well, you saw the report
I had some
from the COG. We have not seen anything from MEPA themselves.
And I thought I would have it.
The town has received.
I thought I would have it here, and I don't.
Yeah, thank
you. Did you help that lady write that report from the COG?
Kimberly McPhee, she did say she received a call from you. I provided them some of the background information from the report that I had given you guys and the review of the application. But then Kimberly wrote it along with the transportation staff. We had several staff show up at the FERCOG as the regional planning agency reviews all of these environmental notice forms and environment. So that's something, and Kip is always very mindful of the town's finances, and he asked how this is paid for, and it did not come out of your contract with the COG, because this is a part of our standard services that are provided to communities through the regional planning agency, so that's just part of her.
There was
and
some
so I provided her information.
Well, there was some information in there that was incorrect, and it had to do with bus stops and other things. And
okay.
Trying not to be biased one way or the other, but the applicant was concerned that the language was such that could trigger him more financial expenditures to meet different disorganizations' requirements. And I don't know.
I noted that they did, so that was the transportation folks. So we had, both our Lingen Hughes program manager and our transportation folks, as I said, a couple people went out. So they must have been the ones. I did note when I read that, the new bus stop, I hadn't spoken to anybody about that, so that must have come from them. We can certainly talk about that further. These aren't absolute requirements.
Right.
These are just things for them to consider.
Yeah.
So certainly if the planning board has a concern about that, then, that could be something you could discuss with the applicant.
Yeah. No, I
Can I we jumped into this. Can I just clarify that? So you're just going to leave them with us?
I've got more than 3 copies.
3 is fine.
3
is fine. All right.
I'm just going to roll them up for you.
Yep.
That's okay.
Well, don't you want to sign them or no?
Might as well have them signed that way in perpetuity. There's no question.
Right, right.
They were signed.
Because we're not going to get because we don't.
These are going to go away.
These go back with him.
Yeah.
And usually they keep a copy too that's signed, paper.
We'll have them. Once we file the Mylar, we'll actually be able to print out the recorded copy of it. So we'll actually have
it. Okay. Stamps and everything.
Yeah. Okay.
So this will be.
Really excited.
So we should sign 3 of these.
For the town's purpose, like somebody, you've seen the staff change.
Doesn't it go and?
That's okay.
But you can, the reason I, you can, but you can always get a copy right online with our signatures.
Oh, there's 100 of them. We only need 3.
Well, it's 3 pages
sets.
Each.
There must be.
He has
3
sets of 3 pages.
2 pages.
Each.
2 pages.
All right, you feel like a rock star.
Oh,
but again, one should, because I think the assessors should usually get something.
Yes.
So it's usually building inspector, assessors,
and planning.
And I don't know now whether your files are
the same
and
as
Dick's
the
are the same.
I probably
there
should.
Was some movement towards that along the way, but I'm not sure how far that effort ultimately went.
Oh, I'm sure it didn't go very far.
I can verify that. So what were you saying?
So as we're starting that, I just wanted to make it clear to everybody, the public included, that what we're talking about is that there was a MEPA, and MEPA stands for
Massachusetts.
New England, I mean, Massachusetts Environmental.
Energy meeting on November 21st, about a dozen people were there. There was someone from the DCR, Department of Conservation and...
MDR, Agriculture?
Right, and then someone from Agriculture. And then a couple people from Council of Governments who both plan land use and transportation. Representative Ben Tony from the applicant.
SBE.
And there was someone else, I think.
I forget who else.
And it says that their MIPA comments are due on or before November 29th. And then the certificate is due December 9th.
Yeah, so the comments had to be in November 29th. And so that certificate back from MIPA would be later this week.
And who does that go to, the certificate?
It would go to the applicant and they would copy.
Okay. So at our next meeting, we can probably take this up. My observation was that the Department of Ag had questions about that it was, used to be farmland and now houses, so they had questions about that. DCR had some questions about that the Sugarloaf and the trail system backs right up into it. One of the questions they had is that, and if you remember the drawings, they said there was going to be a walking path from this development to one of the trails.
That connected up to it, yeah.
He asked if they could have some parking spaces so people from the public could come and park there and then get on the trail. So that was just an interesting...
That's a bad idea.
Point. And I think some of the people participating in the MIPA thing are going to, in their letters, going to mention they would have liked to seen the possibility of this being a more condensed development. What do you call...
A conservation or open space design.
Right.
So...
Because if you remember, the applicant said that he looked into that, but correct. Then decided he couldn't do it because fire...
They had alluded to having
fire department asked him to keep the houses further apart.
This environmental notification form, which is the copy, the hard copy of what the applicant sent in to the MIPA office, includes a couple of alternative concept plans that you all never saw. They were alluded to, like they said, oh, we looked into an open space conservation plan. There's actually a plan here, an alternative plan that they had drawn up. So that might be of interest to you folks to review those towards... Do you have a copy of this?
I do.
There?
It's near the
so
back.
It's actually the very last two pages. You have concept 2A, a conservation subdivision, and concept 1A, attached to family dwellings. So those give you some notion of some of the other alternatives that they had reviewed and had decided against, but you hadn't seen.
So they decided against, meaning the applicant.
The applicant decided that they didn't want to do these for whatever reason. One of the things was they can get more units without doing it. They did also mention the public safety issue and the additional space between the units as a reason for spreading it out, that the fire department liked the ability to get between. So that was one of the other things that they had mentioned, as I recall as well.
So those are something that we might be able to look at. So.
Good night, thank you very much.
Good night.
Bye, thank you.
So at the next meeting, I think we should keep that on our agenda, is to read the MIPA reports.
Can I say it real quick, John?
And then we have not received the definitive site plan yet from the applicant. I was told that it could come...
Is that in digital format, or is that...
I was told that it could come in January or February, but...
I talked with Tony about doing it digitally this next time, which he thought was a great idea.
Well, I meant the MIPA report, if that was
This was not available. Okay. I only ever saw it in hard copy.
Okay.
Any other questions about that?
I just need to go back a minute. Is there anything we need to put in the minutes about the Cumberland Farms thing? You had several reports that you had there. Do you want those listed, or does it matter?
You mean that we reviewed them, or?
Well, you listed about five or six things that he'd given you.
Right.
That was that part of those plans that we saw, or was that something you want to mention?
We should mention that we have
Okay, what are they?
We have a traffic. So I thought we got them.
I'm assuming there's an application form as well that was in the narrative?
There was an application, there was the drawings.
Okay, there's an application?
Site plan review application, with the fee paid, I should have said that also.
Good.
I will double check about the math on the fee, but I think it looked good.
Okay.
There's a stormwater management report?
Two is stormwater management report.
And there's a traffic impact study.
And a traffic study report, so there's three, plus the package you handed out to us.
Plus the drawings.
Plus the drawings.
And there's two of each of them, if anybody wants to take any light reading and study it up.
Traffic study report, okay.
Actually, oh, do you want one?
I would take a set, I'm gonna get them from him digitally as well, but if you have some to give away.
And then the fourth thing was, what did we call that? That was the site plan specifics?
Site plan set, he calls it, but it's, we usually call it the drawings, I don't know.
Site plan drawings, okay, good.
All right, so we'll keep, I had a question, actually. The subdivision is, it's often referred to as a two-family senior residential plan.
Yeah.
I've been told it's 55 and older. That's not, to me, that's not a senior housing.
Just because you're right in that little narrow band there.
Well, the reason why I make this...
Call it AARP.
The reason why I say that is because in our, it is true that in our housing production plan, we talked about senior, and I think a lot of people thought senior was older than 55 and older. So I don't want something that's for 55 and older to replace if the town thinks we need something for people more 65 and over.
I think that's the name that's actually on the plans. That's why it's been continually referred to in that name.
But I just, as a town, I think we should be clear that this is not.
Well, I think as a general rule, John, I'm pretty sure 55 is like the...
It's the date. For AARP, it is.
The housing authorities.
Well, no, they...
I'm in denial on it. Is it 50 for them?
I think it's 50 for them.
But you get what I'm getting at.
I know, I totally get what you're getting at.
I don't want just, if people think, oh, this is gonna satisfy all our senior living needs, but is it really for people 55 to 60? That's not helping the people who are 65 and 70 and 75.
I just... Well, no, it's 55 and up.
Right, 55 and up. But I just happen to know a few people who are in their late 60s who would be interested by that, so...
Yeah, it's an option, it's just not, it's not a senior housing development.
Development, right.
Same, according to what the, I mean, I was at a lot of those meetings and people were talking about people who were...
I think the whole concern is families, and that's not gonna be a family.
Well, a lot of the people that came to our housing production plan wanted even smaller units and, you know, almost more like apartments, some of the need for some seniors.
And that was...
And this isn't, this is houses, you know.
Right.
That got more into the affordable...
Right, and also get into the affordable, right.
Yeah.
Any other business? And we already set a date for the next one.
Yeah, there was a Franklin planning meeting last week.
Oh, yeah.
It was a little bit about some work on the South River in Conway, erosion control. Per usual, the Northfield Mountain water in the Connecticut River rising and lowering at rapid rates when they release and causing erosion. And lastly, there was a speaker there discussing, oh yes, this is probably very important, discussing the tiny houses, zoning for tiny houses, something that we probably want to think about at some point. Pat, do you remember what the other two items were? They were all semi-related to things.
I wasn't
like that
there, but I was told, like, they talked about, in addition to tiny houses, they talked about Airbnb type short-term rentals
Airbnb
that are happening outside of the zoning requirements in most communities.
And Lyft and Uber. So,
and,
what was that again? I didn't understand
Airbnb, it's a way for you to rent people's homes on the portion of their homes online, but they often are running afoul of zoning and
Board
of Health and other requirements in communities. So people who run B&Bs are like, well, we have to go and get all of these permits and everything, and then this guy next door is just doing it online with nothing. So
Joe Smith signs up with the Airbnb site, and all of a sudden now...
Spell that, is it A-I-R?
A-I-R-B-N-B.
Right.
Okay, so I don't know, what's the...
It's like an Uber, but for lodging.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And,
it's the demand economy kind of...
Yeah, and it's...
Disruptive economy.
Probably in this town, it's probably illegal as within many towns because, you know, you don't have any permitting, say you serve food, I mean, it's kind of a mess.
There's also a real interesting discussion nationwide about how it may actually be cutting into the available number of rentals. Because instead of renting them out...
They can get enough money for a
short... For a month or a year, they're doing it night by night.
Right, so
instead. So that's throwing the market for rentals out of whack and making them, less available and more expensive.
So, yeah, it's an unfair playing field for people.
But something new, that's coming along, so everybody's trying to adjust, just like they are with Uber. You know, to try to figure out what is the appropriate regulatory scheme to fit them into, So that's what we're starting to talk about that now.
Right.
But they are being those types too.
So those were the things discussed. I think tiny houses might be a thing we want to talk about someday.
Hmm. Well, Mr. Chairman, one of the other things that had come up at the last meeting was that there's a couple of items like zoning changes, that we've talked about, and you all sort of put them on the other things to be considered later, like you were saying earlier when you're looking at the minutes. And so I went through all my various and sundry notes that I had, and so there were a number of things. The accessory apartment bylaw was one, and so then, and I, because of this thing last week, I also wrote down B&B, the definition. We had looked at the definition of what is a B&B, B and B in town, and then we're looking at all that and look at the Airbnb as well. We had talked about looking at the thresholds for solar installations to be under review because it's really low now at the 10 kW, so that's one thing. And the issue of use variances had come up in the past, and they're not exactly addressed, you recall, in the in your bylaws. They had to go to town council to determine, was it actually there explicitly or not. So that would be something to determine, do you want to allow them or not and make that explicit. So that would be another thing. The medical marijuana overlay district and the dispensary locations and the changes, as has been alluded to already, that may result in recreational marijuana dispensaries being, put into the system on top of those, and maybe trying to get out ahead of that on zoning. Some towns are talking about a moratorium on the recreational dispensaries while they study it. The issue of building height had come up along the way. I'm not entirely sure.
That's increase that one. Yeah.
We wanted to increase that one. And there's been other changes to guidelines. The FAA came out with changes to wireless communication regulations in 2012.
The FAA or FCC?
The FCC, I'm sorry, you're right, it's the FCC. And most of our communities have not gone back to look at their bylaws to determine if they are in compliance with that. So if you're opening up the bylaws for other housekeeping, that might be something to review. There also were some changes that happened this last legislative session, a couple of things that kind of got tacked on here and there. So for one thing, special permits are now 3 years in duration, not two. And nobody even knows hardly that this has happened, much less altered their bylaws and so forth to reflect that statutory change. So that's just the beginning list that I had.
So does it make sense? Because my opinion, we'll never be able to tackle any of this stuff during a regular meeting. Should we have a couple of bonus meetings starting in January? Maybe towards the end of January or something?
Depending on what else you're working on,
what are the top priorities? Solar is the top priority.
Yeah, I think the building height.
That's changing so fast.
Building height is easy. That's low-lying fruit.
Do we need a marijuana district?
I think marijuana is.
I believe that the state is working fast and furious on ways to regulate these things. My understanding of the way it is right now, on the 16th of December, Cumberland Farms in downtown Deerfield could sell pot.
Yeah.
I'm not
not sure that's entirely true. I have to look into that. I think that's something we should look into, and maybe you should be consulting with town council. I know that individuals can legally possess and grow as of December 15th. But I think there's a time frame within which in the next 2 years, there's a regulatory structure before dispensaries would open. So I don't know. I'd have to look into that more clearly.
It depends on how the legislation
was. Legislation is an important thing, but I happened, there was a gentleman here who's, I'm going to just call him by, he's a marijuana lawyer, and I had a conversation with him about it, and he says, yeah, that they will vigorously defend anybody who tries to stop people from selling it in the store. There are certain limits to what they can have, but yeah, they can definitely open up anywhere, and they don't need any special permits.
Yeah.
The health can't regulate them. They would, you know.
All right, so let's.
But it's something that we should, I think, talk about, even though we can't do anything right away.
I agree. I also think we help guide the town to have some kind of sense of what's going to happen, have their mitt out ready to catch whatever information comes along.
Well, if what Kip is saying is correct, we're not sure of that. Shouldn't we be looking at a moratorium so we can figure this out?
Right.
Does that have to go to town meeting?
I don't know what happens with
it. Would be like
we can't just.
That's why I'm.
It would be a zoning bylaw.
It would be a zoning bylaw.
Yeah, but is that legal?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You can't pick something out like that and say it'd be like us saying we think so sugary drinks are bad, so we're gonna have a moratorium. You can't sell sugary drinks until this.
Well, it's akin to what was happened when the wind turbines and solar installations first came along, and a lot of towns passed moratoria for a certain period of time in order to do studies and determine where it would be appropriate to do it. So it can't be a forever, you know, they have to be
timed. And it can't be like sugared soda.
I think the argument there, Pat, is that now this is deemed by, you know, legal vote, that this is now a legal product. So now trying to figure out how you're going to regulate a legal product is different, you know?
Yeah, and we need to look into it.
Yeah, the vote said there's going to be regulated. So right.
There is a board that's being set up to regulate, and I think that there are some time frames set up for, you know, how.
So there are two pieces of mail. Unfortunately, they're kind of late. They're from the zoning board asking requests for comments from us about the signage at Cumberland Farms, but they already had their meeting on December 1st. So I think we're kind of late on that. But it sounds like the zoning board is having another meeting December 15th, if anybody wants to weigh in, and then the CONCOM on December 22nd. So they could be interesting to follow up on, too. One quick observation I just noticed. Did you know that I always thought that headquarters of Yankee Candle was here, but it's in Lexington, Kentucky, apparently.
Oh, it's been moved.
That's where the, at least that's where the notices were sent to abutters.
Oh, really?
And that Crop Production Services is in Loveland, Colorado.
Mm-hmm.
So that's interesting.
So those must be the corporate sponsors, because I know Yankee Candle's has sold a couple of times now.
Yeah.
Well, I think Rubbermaid owns Yankee Candle now.
Yeah, so maybe that's the.
Well, they also have that Coleman down there that's got something.
That's because Rubbermaid, Newell Rubbermaid owns them well.
So, hearing no more comment, does anybody want to make a motion to adjourn?
I make a motion to adjourn.
I'll second it.
Thank you.
All those in favor?
Aye.
At 9:13, Paul.
9:13.
Yeah, let's get that right this time.
Then she'll know. Exactly.